Hi, this is Dave Zanotti from the Public Square. You're about to view the 10th anniversary episode of Christmas in America, which is designed, written, and produced every year as a two-hour live radio variety special. So how come it's on TV? The obstacles to producing this live radio event in 2020 were pretty awful. 6 months into the production, it looked like we had no chance to bring this episode to life because of COVID-19. There was no place to hold an event. Artists were unable to travel. Lockdowns were threatening to cancel Christmas altogether. There was no room at the inn. So we began an alternate plan to create a video presentation and keep this celebration of Christmas alive. What you're about to see is the commitment of a cast of artists, producers, writers, and technicians who simply refuse to give up on Christmas. From the first hour to the very moment this video edition was posted, there were cancellations, closures, failed deliveries, even system collapses at the world's largest internet providers. It seemed like the Grinch was going to win in Whoville in 2020. But the light of Christmas still dawned. And this video is the composite of two live shows in Cleveland, Ohio and Nashville, Tennessee, plus some wonderful original musical video work from our team. This is our first video edition of Christmas in America. You can listen to the full radio concert event with additional songs and stories at thepublicsquare.com. As always, Christmas in America, on radio or TV, is presented as a gift from the caring people who financially support the nonprofit mission of the Public Square. We thank all of you for your partnership. Thank you for listening and now viewing this first video edition of our annual tradition called Christmas in America on the Public Square.
The year is 1968. America is embroiled in a Cold War with the Soviet Union and a shooting war in Vietnam. A pandemic called the Hong Kong flu is sweeping the nation. In March, President Lyndon Johnson announces he will not seek re-election. In April, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. is slain. In June, Bobby Kennedy is struck down by an assassin. In August, the Democratic National Convention is held in Chicago, and thousands of protesters engage in a bloody conflict with the Chicago police. And the nation begins to burn in political riots, racial riots, and the anti-war riots. Many people believed America was at the end. Many of you listening right now remember how that felt. So how did the nation survive? Thank you. 1968, and this is Christmas in America. Hello again, and welcome to the 10th anniversary episode of Christmas in America on the Public Square. My name is Wayne Shepherd. Together, we've gone looking for the manger these past 10 years. Joining us today is the founder of the Public Square Media Network and the author and historian behind today's celebration. Happy 10th anniversary, and welcome my good friend and partner, Dr. David Zanotti.
Thank you, Wayne. Thank you. And my thanks, as always, Wayne, for you showing up again another year.
Oh, I love to do it. Thank you.
This is our 21st show that we've done together, yeah, Christmas in America.
I think I had brown hair when we started.
So, let's go back to the early 60s. Kids in most towns could hop on their bikes, ride down to the local store or swimming pool, be gone for hours without parents being afraid at all. In fact, I can remember a book that came out in 1962. I remember this book because it was on the Scholastic Reading List, which meant that kids that were in school back then, mm-hmm, in the early 60s could scrape together their paper route money, which I did, and buy Three Boys in Space.
Wow, sounds fascinating, Dave.
And it's still one of my favorite books to this very day. I read it in 1963. Huh. So this was the early 60s. By the time we got to the late 60s, it's much more like that documentary video piece you just saw. Life began to change dramatically across the nation. Mm. In 1968, life got intense, every bit as much as it feels like that right now. We selected 1968 for this edition of Christmas in America back in early November 2019, long before anyone would begin to talk about how much 2020 would be a mirror of the past, a reflection of how much America looked, what it was like back in 1968. In 1968, here's a sound you might remember. Let's see. In 1968,
the transistor radio.
You heard a lot of this. Actually, well, you didn't hear that sound.
No, it was better than that.
You heard that sound. Why? Because in 1968, this was the internet. Right here. Mm-hmm. And music carried the message of the culture. Yep. The Billboard Top 100 hits contained a completely diverse group of artists and genres of music. We had it all in 1968. We had the Beatles, Elvis, Otis Redding, Cream, The Fifth Dimension, The Supremes, Steppenwolf, Tom Jones, The Bee Gees, The Mamas and the Papas, The Vogues, and Herb Alpert, just to name a few.
Yeah, and don't forget nighttime television on three channels, remember? Thankfully, none of them were cable news. There was a code of practice known as the television code that prohibited, get this, the use of profanity, a lack of respect for God or religion, negative portrayals of marriage and family, and portrayals of drunkenness, drug addiction, and promiscuity. Little wonder the most popular program on television was on Sunday night. Yes, sir. Four cowboys would ride up on the screen from the place called the Ponderosa. Starting back in 59, the Cartwrights ruled the TV ratings. And then in 1968, something happened over at CBS.
Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour, 0204, show number 3, take 1.
It's the Smothers Brothers Comedy Hour with guest stars Barbara Feldon, Bill Medley, Pat Carlson, and from London, special guest stars, the Beatles, the Jimmy Joy singers, the Ron Poindexter dancers, and Nelson Riddle and his orchestra.
So there may be some interpretation necessary. Those two guys, Dick and Tommy Smothers, they were comedians and musicians. They also had a writing team on their program that included Steve Martin, Don Novella, Rob Reiner, that's Meathead, mm-hmm, Don Novello is Father Narducci on SNL. Pat Paulson, who was perpetually running for president, and Mason Williams, who happens to be the person that wrote the song that opened the show, Classical Gas.
Yep.
A tremendous amount of talent as well as agenda. The Smothers Brothers versus Bonanza might be a way of understanding 1968. There was an ideological revolution going on. Some called it the generation gap, some called it racial discord, or the anti-war movement, or perhaps all three. The Smothers Brothers and their ideological partners on the left hit prime time and took on the traditional Cartwrights. Nobody thought they had a chance. Just before the presidential election of 1968, the Smothers Brothers pulled a network coup. They landed an appearance with a musical group from England on a Sunday night right before the election.
Hi. If you watched our show last week, you saw the Beatles singing Hey Jude. And if you also watched the show the week before, you didn't see Harry Belafonte singing Please Don't Stop the Carnival, which has nothing to do with the fact that the Beatles will now sing Revolution. Or does it?
In 1968, AM radio was the internet. Television was bringing pictures of the societal upheaval into every household every night. And the music of the era was leading that revolution. So it would be impossible to cover this pivotal year without focusing on the power of music and media. Of course, we're not inventing this observation. The power of music and culture is a reality that has been often noted throughout history. So, for this 10th anniversary episode of Christmas in America, our storyline contains two themes. First, we visit 1968 and find the manger in that most turbulent year. And we add to the story a backstage pass for all of you, a behind-the-scenes look at how we've been writing, arranging, performing, and sharing music across the world in support of the greatest story of all time, the true story of Christmas.
Ring, ring, ring the bells this merry Christmas time. Ring, ring, ring the bells, sweet joy sublime. Tell the good news to all you may find. Jesus, the Savior is born. Join with the shepherds on bended knee, for Jesus, the Savior is born. Oh, Jesus, the Savior is born. La 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 Jesus, the Savior. Jesus, the Savior.
How did the song come together?
Well, that song came from the pen of Fanny Crosby, and it was discovered in the archive of her unpublished works. You helped us to find those unpublished works at Wheaton College.
Well, back in 1968, another legendary artist was working to put the pieces of his career back together. Elvis Presley was 33 years old. His musical career was fading. Presley was contracted by NBC with a proposition of a comeback television special. So on December 3, 1968, Presley shocked the world in what would become the number one television special of the year. In that same year, a gospel quartet from Akron, Ohio, called The Cathedrals, would record a song that Elvis Presley loved. The song, written a few years earlier by Bill Gaither, was titled He Touched Me. Shortly after that recording, a group called The Imperials would record another arrangement of He Touched Me, which Elvis loved even more. Elvis took that arrangement into the studio and recorded He Touched Me as the lead song of a brand new gospel album. It was this album that earned Elvis his second Grammy Award. Well, in 2020, our dear friends Ernie Haas and Signature Sound put together a brand new album titled Something Beautiful. This collaboration project with Bill and Gloria Gaither became an instant hit. And here is the video of the revival of that classic song, He Touched Me, by Ernie Haas and Signature Sound.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome one of Nashville's most respected musicians, a regular performer at the Grand Ole Opry with the Time Jumpers, and America's cowboy band, the Riders in the Sky, our dear friend, Mr. Jeff Taylor.
Thank you, Dave.
For years, Jeff has granted us permission to bring his beautiful music to listeners here in the public square. We think that Jeff's accordion on that Something Beautiful CD from Ernie Haas is the secret sauce. And by the way, That album has just been nominated for a 2020 Grammy Award.
Now, Jeff's so proficient with the accordion and the pump organ and the mandolin and an array of flutes, penny whistles, hurdy-gurdy, and other instruments that a lot of people don't realize that this multi-award-winning artist is wonderful at the piano as well. For 10 years, I've been listening to Jeff's solo albums in my office nonstop, almost every day. And for 10 years, I have been wanting to share this Christmas gift with you. Ladies and gentlemen, on the piano, Mr. Jeff Taylor.
especially for me.
This might work.
In the 1960s, the Mamas and Papas were one of the hottest groups in America. They sold millions of records, topped the charts. Then in 1968, fractured by interpersonal issues, they broke up. On her way off the scene, Mama Cass helped put together the broken pieces of a few other groups into a new act. She hosted Stephen Stills, Graham Nash, and David Crosby at her place in the Laurel Canyon. And shortly thereafter, CSN, Crosby, Stills, and Nash, were born. They would become one of the most influential musical groups of the anti-war movement, and one of the most popular covers that they ever did was this song, which you probably all have somewhere in your attic or basement. Mm-hmm. You remember this album,
yep.
One of the songs that yep. people loved the most.
I haven't. You told me that that's Mama Cass's front porch.
There it is, right there in the Laurel Canyon.
I never knew that.
Yep. One of the best songs was a song called, they covered, called Blackbird.
Singing in the dead of night, take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night, take these sunken eyes and learn to see all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to be free. Blackbird fly, blackbird fly into the light of a dark. Singing in the dead of night, take these broken wings and learn to fly all your life. You were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird fly, blackbird. Blackbird fly into the
record was a 1968 song written by Paul McCartney and John Lennon. McCartney has commented that the song was written as he reflected upon the racial tensions tearing America apart. In 1968, the Beatles founded Apple Studios, but the chaos of the era began to break the most successful band of the century apart. The pattern was repeating all across the music industry. Amazing talent and success was being torn asunder by the despair of drugs, the sexual revolution, and broken relationships.
In 1968, a new author emerged. He wrote on philosophy, theology, and art. He was headquartered in Switzerland and published his first three books all at the same time. Kind of interesting. Three boys in space,
yeah.
Three networks, three books. That theme just
it keeps popping up.
Last night, yeah. I noticed that in the script, right? After all these shows. Yeah. All right, the three books were titled The God Who Is There, Escape from Reason, and He Is There and He Is Not Silent. Dr. Francis A. Schaeffer wrote to all people, challenging the basic thought structure of modern culture. He contended that modern philosophy had placed an artificial ceiling over the universe, a ceiling which permitted people to pretend that they were living alone in a godless mindset that Schaeffer called autonomy. This autonomy, Dr. Schaeffer predicted, would ultimately lead society to hopelessness and despair, because without the Creator God, mankind could find no way to make sense of the world, no way to hold the pieces, the good and the bad, the pieces of life all together. No one saw Francis Schaeffer coming back in 1968, but young people and youth leaders and students and scholars from around the world started journeying to the Schaeffer's headquarters at Le Brie in Switzerland, looking for real answers to real questions. On your program, you see the words 1968, a year like no other. But was it really? Think of all the parallels. A brand new virus, pandemic across the world, political assassinations, violence in the streets, protests, the anti-war movement. The list goes on, and economic uncertainty.
Right.
It goes on and on and on. Are these all parallels? Or is this a coincidence? Is there a pattern to history? Three boys, three books, three networks, three kings. In Christmas in America, episode number 3, we put together a new arrangement of the classic song, I Wonder As I Wander. As we were thinking about this 10th anniversary episode, we knew we wanted to reprise this song in a video so that we could preserve this work by Chris and Sarah for years to come. This song fits the spirit of 1968 and this moment in 2020 better than any we could imagine. A culture desperately wondering if mankind could make it alone or if our only hope would be found in looking upward once again toward the star of Bethlehem.
Jesus.
The year is 1968, and as the months wore on, the strife in America grew worse. The pandemic expanded, racial tensions exploded. The Democratic Convention ended in blood flowing across Chicago. America voted for a president, and the music of the revolution continued.
Hey Jude, don't make it bad. Take a sad song and make it better. Remember to let her into your heart. Then you can start to make it better. Hey Jude, don't be afraid. You were made to go out and get her. The minute you let her under your skin, then you'll begin to make it better.
That song feel a little long to you?
I was hoping for the 7-minute version, actually.
Ah, 7 minutes yeah. and 11 seconds, to be precise. But there is a limit to how much audience swaying is permitted in any given Christmas variety show.
Yes. Well, this episode is different, Dave, than any we've ever done. Looking back to a year that many of us remember, and then finding so many historic parallels to this very hour, I don't think we've ever seen this before.
Now, everything that happened back in 1968 was not as serious as a heart attack. The Detroit Tigers won the World Series. The Cleveland Browns played for the NFL championship in a rematch with the Baltimore Colts. Browns lost.
Yeah, okay.
Beginning their journey of not making it to the Super Bowl for 54 straight years. Pause for effect. But on a lighter note, the Big Mac was introduced in 1968, as was the McDonald's apple pie. Hot Wheels were the hottest toy at Christmas time, and there was a new hit TV show called The Monkees.
The Monkees. So the Monkees, they weren't musicians. I mean, they did a TV show. That was probably an insult to all the musicians in the band.
At least the serious ones. Yeah, it was a little bit opposite.
Right.
However, let's get back to the real story and the real music of Christmas. C.S. Lewis wrote about Christmas in this way. Once in our world, a stable had something in it that was bigger than our whole world. Christmas is the bridge that invites all people to come back to the beginning. All of history and all of human culture, ancient and current, divides on this moment in time, the day the Savior came to earth. So as a mission outreach to America, we have a calling to start with Christmas. Every year we pick a year in history and we go looking for the manger.
Which sounds like a great theme for a Christmas song. For our radio audience, the video of this next song is kind of like a Christmas card from London. The sender is our very dear friend, the legendary songwriter, Chris Eaton.
A night oh so silent, hushed worship in awe. The hope of the nations lies swaddled in straw. All of creation once flowed through these hands, so tiny and precious, Creator now man. Sweet echoes of angels, the star in the sky, the wise man pursuing the one sent to die. Emmanuel's land is now open to all, the door to that city. Sweet echo.
Jesus teaches, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Over the years, we've discovered that the closer we get to the manger, the more we are challenged to deepen our commitment to childlike wonder. And the closer we get to this moment of celebrating Christmas every year, the more things seem to go wrong.
At least with us, don't they?
To say there's a spiritual contest over the reality of Christmas would be a cosmic understatement. In the midst of that spiritual battle, we have seen miracles.
Yeah.
Now, there are so many examples that we had a hard time picking just one. But I want to ask Patty and Rob and Alan and Anna and everyone, Wayne, remember the big red piano story? This goes the whole way back to the very first episode of Christmas in America. We were so concerned about making sure that all of these wonderful artists felt that they were really being appreciated. So we got the best input, and we rented the biggest, baddest red keyboard. You guys all know what those are called. I'll leave the name off of it. It was a big one, and it cost a boatload.
It was impressive.
Of money. It was a very impressive. I thought you could like water ski with it, or you know, to drive it home. It's a big deal. And so, first show, we're all nervous. What time do we open doors, etc.? And artists came in from all over the country, and there was a fantastic African American quartet that came to join us. Beautiful work, and we're so grateful to have them. And they were on the rehearsal schedule. They had to come in a little bit later because it was after church. So they got there, and there wasn't a lot of time left, and their piano player couldn't make it last minute. Well, everyone in this quartet played piano. There's just one problem. When they sat down at the big red piano to play, it didn't work.
It was a dud.
Now, it had been working in the whole rehearsal up to that moment. We all looked at each other. Everyone tried everything. All the technical wizards in the room tried every single thing you could imagine. And we basically have a dead piano. We're 15 minutes, the door's opening. This group has not rehearsed. And they pick up the phone. They call for a new piano player. All right, the new piano player heads on his way. There's nothing. So what do we do? What do we do? There's one piano left in this hall. It is a big, old, upright piano that hasn't been played forever and probably not tuned in a century.
Probably couldn't be tuned.
Yes. So we unplug 57 mic cords as people are coming through the doors, roll this old black piano, big black old bag, right into the stage, and we go to lift the lid to mic it, and the lid cracks in two. True story. Put the mic on. It's time to go. This is the piano. And it's like, we are all going to die. We're doomed. Well, here's what happened. A Christmas miracle. The new piano player showed up. We think to this day he was an angel. We think he disappeared, went back with Clarence at the end of Wonderful Life, never was seen from again.
Angel unaware, yeah. Yes. Yeah.
He showed up. He sat down at that piano, and the soloist from this group performed this excerpt, you have to hear this, of Sweet Little Jesus Boy.
Sweet little Jesus Boy, they made you be born in a manger. Sweet little holy child, We didn't know who you were.
The point here is this. The manger is always messy, isn't it? Jesus comes to us in real time, in real space, and often into the midst of our biggest mess-ups.
And the closer we get to him, the greater our sense of wonder in who he is and what he does. Yeah.
All right, there have to be some stories of changed lives, some miracles of Christmas through Christmas in America.
After 10 years, we've got some memories. The woman who came to the afternoon show and asked if there were extra tickets. She wanted to bring some friends back for the evening show. We thought, that's pretty cool. She came back with her mom and her sister. The three of them hadn't spoken for 14 years. Wow. They walked out of the second show arm in arm together. There's the story of the grandfather who brought 14 kids to the show. His kids, grandkids, nephews, and nieces. I'll never forget that whole group together.
Beautiful.
Then there was an older lady who came, the matriarch of her family, who came to the 1942 show, The War Years. And she was in her 80s plus and had been a holdout on faith her whole life. She came to the show, and her family was quite grateful, and a few weeks after that, she passed away. What we didn't know was that the day after the show, she went to church and gave her life to Christ.
Oh, beautiful. Yeah, beautiful.
And her family credits that her eyes and her heart were opened, yeah, participating in, yeah, Christmas in America. And then there's the story of the kids. You've seen them if you've been here before. Hundreds of them taking home copies of C.S. Lewis's The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe for the first time, singing Christmas songs all the way home in the car. And then the letters from listeners. We had several listeners come up in between shows and tell us these stories. We get to read these letters every year because they're listening to this show around the Christmas tree with, yeah, their family. Yeah. So when we started out, we had no idea how to do this, no idea how to draw star power to this project, for fear that if we didn't bring star power and big names, people wouldn't come. Then we discovered something. Christmas has its own star. God has drawn amazingly talented artists, writers, producers, and performers to help in this effort, and oftentimes we don't promote who's coming. We don't tell you all the things that are going on behind the scenes. We all just show up because we're not looking for a star. We're looking for the star and the manger. One of the most amazing miracles of all has been the growth of the Public Square Media Network over these past 10 years. People said we were nuts for starting with Christmas. What would a public policy organization do starting their radio broadcast year with Christmas? That doesn't make any sense. The only problem is now the radio program is on over 200 stations, online, with video outreach. We cover thousands and thousands of people, and this program, both the audio and the video product, will be seen eventually by millions of people. And that, to us, is a miracle beyond imagination, as we've sought the manger. Now, all of this has caused our board and our friends to make a commitment to build a new broadcast center to undergird the public square. Our goal is to connect our studios in Nashville, Orlando, Cleveland, and Chicago. The new American Mission Center in Valley City, Ohio, will help every state in the union link into the work of the Public Square Media Network.
Several of us visited the site of the American Mission Center this morning. Members of the band were there, I was there, and I thought of what C.S. Lewis said. Is any pleasure on earth as great as a circle of Christian friends by a good fire? Now, we couldn't start a fire there today because it isn't completed. The building's not done. But as we walked through those empty rooms, I silently prayed in each room, especially in the radio studio. I'm a studio rat, sorry. But in that radio studio, which is so wonderfully designed, I thought, think of how God will be honored by the use of this building. So pray with us for the completion of the American Mission Center. For all of our radio listeners and those watching on television or online, we are gathered here to celebrate and to bring a gift to help complete the American Mission Center. We invite you to join this adventure. For more details, just visit us at thepublicsquare.com.
Three boys in space, three books, three networks, three kings.
Three fireplaces.
Three fireplaces at the American Mission Center. So we can't miss that line from C.S. Lewis, right?
Right.
A circle of great friends, because that's what we're after. Yeah. A collaboration. That's another word for the fellowship of the saints. What's amazing about collaboration around the manger is there's room for everyone. All styles, all genres, all people groups. At Christmas time, we sing the same songs every year, but in so many different ways that each time they mean something more.
In 1968, there was a single television news special that was viewed by more people worldwide than any TV program in history.
In all of history.
In all of history.
Worldwide.
It was a very unusual Christmas special from a very remote location. You can imagine what I'm talking about. It featured, again, three pioneers who were on a mission to win the race to the moon. American astronauts Frank Borman, Jim Lovell, Bill Anders of the Apollo 8 crew were the first men to orbit the moon and return safely to Earth. It was Christmas Eve, 1968, that NASA turned the cameras on and the astronauts showed the world how the Earth looked rising over the moon. No one had ever seen the world from that point of view. The crew's greatest challenge in the broadcast was the audio. They had no script. The only instruction given by NASA was, say something appropriate. They asked a few friends who were professional writers and journalists, but nothing seemed to fit the moment when the whole world would be watching live. Finally, the wife of a friend, also a writer, who had been a member of the French Resistance in World War II, made a suggestion. Start at the beginning, she told the Apollo crew, and they did.
Now approaching lunar sunrise, and for all the people back on Earth, the crew of Apollo 8 has a message that we would like to send to you. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness.
And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters. Let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament, the waters which were above the firmament. And it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day.
God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together into one place. And let the dry land appear, and it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters called these seas. And God saw that it was good. And from the crew of Apollo 8, we close with good night, good luck, a Merry Christmas, and God bless all of you on the good earth.
What was happening on the moon on Christmas Eve, 1968, was happening around the nation. People were seeing the world from a different point of view. In 1968, the Byrds chose to cover a song written by Carole King and Jerry Goffin. It was a song that lots of artists began to sing. The song was like a sign in the sky, or maybe even a sign on the radio, revealing that a change of mind was coming. People were tired of the revolution. They were going back to the beginning.
I think I'm going back to the things I learned so well in my youth. I think I'm returning to
catch me if you can. I'm
reason, the God who is there, he is there and he is not silent. The three titles of the three books by Francis A. Schaeffer published in 1968. Is it a coincidence that the core conflicts of 1968 are playing out again in our headlines in 2020? Or would Dr. Schaeffer tell us that culture follows philosophy? The way people view life really determines how they live life. When people are walking toward the Creator, they're walking toward the light and the light of liberty. But when they're walking away from that light, they're moving toward the shadowlands. In 1968, American youth culture reached the end of the road. People discovered that modern autonomy is a soulless myth. And they began to turn away from the fractured world of protests, addictions, and despair. They began to look up, to call out to the God who is there. And when they did, they found he is not silent. They began to find real answers to real questions in the person of Jesus Christ. The scripture tells us that Jesus is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For by him all things were created, both in the heavens and the earth, visible and invisible. Whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. Francis Schaeffer explained the crisis of modern man in terms of autonomy, trying to live our lives alone, putting ourselves in the center of the universe. But it doesn't work. We cannot hold it all together. Ultimately, our autonomous world falls apart. Schaeffer continued to write until his death in 1984. His theme was always the same. The worldview of a culture creates inevitable consequence. The key word in that statement is inevitable. In other words, it doesn't matter what year we're in, the godless equation always leads to the same result, which just might be why the headlines of 2020 look so much like the headlines of 1968. Let's take a moment and let the late Dr. Schaeffer explain.
There was a time in the days when the Christian culture was more dominant, when the lone individual could stand up with the Bible in his hand and say, you're wrong, even though the majority has voted the other way. But as the Christian consensus is gone, then there is no absolute by which to judge the 51%. And then this is a very, very different situation. I'll give you a sentence that I wish you'd memorize. If there is no absolute by which to judge society, society is absolute. The heart of the humanist thinking is making the individual man and then mankind the center of all things, his own measure, of making him autonomous. If we're going to live and escape death, not only death individually in the sense of the judgment of God, but death in our culture, in our political life, in our present life, we must turn from that humanist way of making man autonomous, and we must put the Creator at the center of all things. The greatest of all wickedness is putting any created thing in the place of the Creator. And when we turn from this, our feet are turned from the paths of death to the paths of life.
In 1968, a new faith began rising in America. People began to hold Bible studies, Jesus rallies, baptisms on the California beaches. New outreach works began by Campus Crusade, Youth for Christ, Chuck Smith, Don Finto, and hundreds more. New churches and coffee houses began to spring up across the nation. A whole new genre of worship music was born. A revival began. So the question is, shall we keep trying to hold this life together in 2020 alone? Can we with childlike wonder admit in the quietness of our own souls that there is a God and we are not Him? Can we admit that we need His help in America today? Jesus said it this way, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in to him and sup with him, and he with me." Is it time we open that door as individuals, as families, as communities, and as a nation on this very day? No law can force us to do this. No messenger can compel us. This is and always will be a personal choice only you and I can make. It is a matter of the heart.
Snow had fallen, snow and snow, snow.
would like to learn more about personal faith in Jesus Christ, we encourage you to visit caninogod.com. caninogod.com. The site is honest and sincere and has helped millions to learn more about new life in Christ. Thank you for joining us for this 10th anniversary episode of Christmas in America. Special thanks to our friends and musical guests, Chris Rodriguez, Dennis Holt, Matt Stanfield, Chad Carruthers, George Mondera, Dave's Highway, Sarah Catherine Jackson, Chris Eaton, Jeff Taylor, Ernie Haas, and Signature Sound, our musical director, John Hartley, and executive producer for the Public Square, Alan C. Duncan. And a special thanks to all of our listeners who have brought you this program through their generous contributions to the Public Square Radio. If you would like to join them and help spread this message of hope across the land, please make your tax-deductible contribution at thepublicsquare.com. The address again, thepublicsquare.com. On behalf of the whole team here at the Public Square, I'm Wayne Shepherd. Merry Christmas to all, and to all a good night.